All right, very great. Want to just give a brief overview of these videos. The main point of all these videos is to encourage people to have a great work ethic on the spiritual path, the path of clarification and consideration. It's all important. If you don't have a good work ethic, you're never going to succeed. So the secret to success is your work ethic. That's it. So if you come across something in these videos that you don't like, you don't get it, it's bothersome, or this or that, whatever, don't worry about it. That always happens, and no matter what path you take, you'll come across that. That's not important. What's important is your own habits to continually work within your own clarification. That's what's really important. So, for example, when I'm study A Course in Miracles or read it and pay attention to it, there'll be things that I come across that I say, huh? I don't quite get that. Or just I feel a little, say, I'm not sure. That's fine. Okay. No problem. Keep on reading. Keep on considering. Keep on focusing. Don't get stuck on saying, oh, I've got to resolve this irritation or something. Forget it. It's not important. It is really not important. Because ultimately, the only thing that counts is exchanging ideas. Choose a new idea. Exchange hypotheticals. Instead of what if reality were impermanent, we say what if reality were permanent. Exchange those two. Anything short of that is completely futile, as a matter of fact. Totally ineffective and futile. Anything short of that. So don't get stuck anywhere. Don't get stuck anywhere. Just keep on with your own efforts. Keep your efforts going. That is the number one. So these videos are frequent and they're long because it gives an opportunity to develop that toughness. The spiritual path requires toughness. It's like a marathon runner. You're not going to run a marathon unless you get out there and you do your, 5 miles a day or 4 miles a day or something. You're grinding it out and you're working hard, and then one day you're able to run the marathon. So, again, your work ethic is what counts. And when I talk about the world, what I'm pointing out in the modern culture, what's happening is the loss of that spiritual work ethic and a drastic departure away from it, and a lack of emphasis upon it, which is so severe that it is truly worth commenting upon as far as reminding people, better not go with the current. When in Rome, do as Romans do. Of course, we have to function in this present day and age. You've got no choice for that. But along with that, and it's actually the primary thing, you have to continuously be using all circumstances in your life to help you focus in on additional clarification. Use any expedient you can to do so. So that's the whole point of the videos is this effort is to keep encouraging people to keep trying. Keep trying. Don't give up. Don't say, the times are too much with me. I don't think I can make it. And I'm just going to kind of succumb to the the situation, present day situation. Don't have to succumb to it. You don't have to succumb. You can continue your efforts even though it's difficult. You get up in the morning and you work out. It's hard to keep doing that, but that's what it takes. And you will find that your own ability, you will have it there. You will have it there. If you're a runner and you run every day, someday you may need to run and you will find, hey, I can do it. It's not a problem. I can do it. So the world is going towards what's called the tribulation time. We're in it. We're going to be feeling that. And what I'm concerned about is people getting caught up in that, which is not a good thing. Sure, events happen, and you may have to pay lip service to it just so you can, just people think that you're with it. But then you have to bounce right back and get right back on the horse, Yesterday, I woke up to the headlines of George Jones has passed on. Now, he's just about my favorite human being on the whole entire planet, someone I respect more than just about anybody, actually. And had an enormous influence on my life. Helped me through tough times. His music really helped me greatly. And so his passing away was a monumental event for me. Focused on it for a day, and then, you know what? Time to get back on track here. You cannot, the troubles in Boston, that another thing, you know, if, okay, it's time to get back on track. Events continuously happen in this world, and if you cannot use any of them as an excuse to let your efforts wane. Have to continuously. And now, of course, there will be a few that seem to be more than others, and if you take a day off or half a day, or you don't have full concentration on that day, that's okay. That's to be expected. Just get right back on the horse and start riding it again. So again, nobody will succeed on the path of clarification unless they work at it, have a great work ethic. Nobody's, no way. So your work ethic is your key. That is the key to the highway, that is the key to the kingdom. That is the key to the kingdom. The work ethic is the key to the kingdom. So that's why I say these videos are valuable. Beyond any content they have, is actually setting the example of a work ethic, saying that this is what you have to do. You have to do it. And the world is incredibly divorced from that concept. So there's so few examples of that in the world now, which is that's the drastic problem. When I talk about a better culture, what I mean is that the spiritual work ethic will be front and center of such a culture. And all the rest of the stuff, we'd realize it's not essential at all. It's not essential. It's inessential. And inessentials need to be put in the right perspective. So we have a culture now that's upside down. It puts the inessential in the place where it ought not to be, you see, and neglects the essential as if it were inessential. And this is a disaster. And when I speak about a different culture, world culture, I'm speaking of the future, because there are many dwelling places, actually, in the universe, and there are many 3D worlds, and everyone will find themselves in some other place, in time, with the necessity of doing the path of clarification. And it's good to have the overview of what is the best culture to have in a world. Obviously, this culture here is a goner. It is an absolute goner. I don't see it when I don't see a trace of the right emphasis in the world. I don't even see a trace of it. It's virtually extinct. As we know, when you run an ecosystem down beyond the point of no return, you know, that's what happens. Ecosystems do break down. Just like civilizations break down, focus breaks down. It absolutely does. And this present one is a goner. It is really a goner. And that's why I say we're at the end of an era. And have to reset, reboot, and have, and the more that one is focused on that, the better they're able to go with the reboot and flourish under that kind of circumstance. Because certainly, just like previous in this world, in a rebooted situation, there'll be teachers, there'll be systems set up to help people and get the right kind of focus. It's all important. Now, as far as clarification, the big goal is to see the big picture, to see the whole picture. And it's actually very, very simple. The entire picture is very simple. And that has to be the goal. What we are dealing with here is what we call time. And the ability, the capacity to see what is time. What is time actually? Is a great mystery, isn't it? And recently, I've been able to see that, but it's not come easy. That is for sure. In fact, there's been a lifetime effort to see what is time actually. Very elusive, trying to get the right perspective on time, but it is absolutely possible to do so. And we will continue on with time until we see what it really is. And so, another thing that's important is to recognize that it's okay to be a little ragged. We are raised in a culture right now, we're so used to the media, and everything in the media is, we're seeing, is so actually very controlled and precise, because of all the sponsorship and money involved. Everything is segmented, and they have to take a break here, break there, this is a segment, and everything is so measured and calculated and controlled, and you can't have any dead air time, and people can't just freewheel it, you see. So that's very bad, as a matter of fact, because the path of clarification is very much a freewheeling kind of situation. So in other words, it's okay to not have anything to say for a while or take a break or anything. There's no clock ticking here. There's no clock. There's no sponsorship. There's no commercials. There's no pressure at all. It's super important. We don't realize how our media culture has put us in a box where everything is like a tweet, a soundbite, and boom, like this, and like the radio, blah, 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 and television, and everything that is produced, it's all produced, and it's all costing the sponsors a lot of money, so everything has to be very, very thoroughly vetted and run on a timetable, etc. Here, no timetable. When I sit down to tape, I don't have the slightest thought about time, about how long will I tape. I don't have any idea what I'll say, and breaks just happen when there's a thread of thought is expressed, and we just sit there and quietly. No need to grab another one quickly. This is the proper world type of culture. And that has gone with the wind. Very much so. The trend. People can't stand quietude of speaking and then just... No thoughts appearing in your mind at all. You know, what's the program, people? No program. Nothing pre-planned. No program. Freewheeling. So your contemplation needs to be freewheeling. You don't say, well, I'm going to sit down for 5 minutes. And that's it. You can have a little bit of that. Nothing wrong with a little bit of that. But my tendency has always been to not bow to time. I tend to always be on time, but I don't think about time, and I don't structure my life around time at all. Very much a freewheeling type of thing. So I don't fit into the human paradigm well at all, which these days is measurement-based, time-based, precision-based, all that kind of stuff. I don't bow to time at all. Good thing. Very good thing. So I don't relate to machines at all, because machines, of course, is everything is intricate timing. So we are in a situation that it makes it super difficult to take a successful path. Super difficult. Because we try to structure the path. And the more you structure the path, the more hooked into time you get. And then the more resistance there is. So catch 22. Beautiful day here. Wow. What you have to do, the spiritual path is often, when you're working on clarification, it's like running up a hill. When you get to the top of the hill, you know you need to take a break and just catch your breath, because we're going up very steep inclines, very, very steep. So you do the effort, mental effort, and then just let your mind be quiet. Don't force any quietude. If it comes, it comes. Don't be trying to regiment your being. Everything here in the world is so regimented now, isn't it? More and more and more regimentation. And the more people get regimented, the smarter they are. I'd like to play on a private golf course, because sometimes you go to the next hole and you just want to sit there and just enjoy the beauty and the quiet of it, and you don't want to tee off. Forget it. Spend 20 minutes just being quiet, meditating, just centering in with timelessness. Somebody comes along, just, hey, just play through. Don't be in a hurry. Don't think, okay, I just got to go regimented, you know, the whole round is regimented, that kind of thing. Forget that. Sometimes I feel like I hit the balls down into hazards and stuff, just so I can go hiking down in the canyons and looking for stuff, and like a nature hike. Just as an excuse to do it. I mean, if I just hit every ball right in the boom, 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 what fun is that? You know, hit it in the bushes. Go look, go up in the bushes. Go into the jungle a little bit. And, you know, just don't have it so regimented. The information is simple enough that we don't have to be all frantic about it. It's easily explained. But if we think we have to regiment it, then we lose the essence of it. What we're headed towards is timelessness, the bliss of timelessness. Now, we can give the central teaching, but maybe we can, let's see if it will come up. The thing about the teaching is you have to see it all as one, not separate parts. Because then you'll start to say, well, I can rearrange the parts this way and that way and that way. No, it's not. It's an entire picture. It's one picture. So what's important is it's like looking at a picture. Don't try to overly fixate on any part of the picture, thinking it's a part of it. No, there are no parts to a picture. The essence of a picture is the totality of the picture. So what you want to do is you want to practice seeing the totality of it. All right. Which is why trying to focus in on one aspect of it, it's better to just let that slide by. Not important. The capacity to see the entire picture. Okay, why are we here sharing the time? Why? Because we're spirit and we chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator. That is why. See, this is the big picture. That's why we're here in this dream of time, actually. What is existence? It's a dream of time. It's a hypothetical of time. What if? Okay, now why? We chose the idea of why to be prime creator. Why have we ended up with this dream of time? Okay, so see, these are the big questions. Quite simply, reality is one indivisible whole. There are no parts to it. What is true of all of reality equally. So when we say, Spirit says, I want to be prime creator, well, that would mean that we'd have to change reality because we're in prime creator. But reality is one indivisible whole. To change it, to actually change reality, when you say, I need to change reality, in order to be prime creator, I have to change reality, that actually means that reality would have to be annihilated. Completely gone. It's not like you can rearrange parts of it. It doesn't have any parts. So, the desire for spirit to be prime creator really brings about the effect. The effect of that idea, entertain that idea, the effect, hey, what if I were prime creator? That idea. The effect of that is a feeling of annihilation. Now, mind presents ideas to spirit. So how does mind present this idea of spirit wanting to be prime creator? The effect has to be one of annihilation. How does mind present annihilation? Because the reality can't be annihilated. So the mind is still there, but it has to present annihilation to spirit as the effect of this idea. You see, in reality, ideas and their effects are instantaneous. They're one. There's no gap between an idea and its effects. It's a seamless oneness. So the idea of wanting to be prime creator, the effect that goes with mind presents that, how? By total mental confusion, chaos, mental chaos, utter chaos, complete chaos everywhere, with nothing but chaos. That's how mind presents annihilation. Now, this is totally intolerable to spirit. And so spirit says, whoa, instantly says, I don't want this effect. So what spirit can do, two options at this point. It can choose a new idea. Say, okay, what if I didn't want to be prime creator? What if I accept reality as it is instead of trying to change it? And then the effect of that would just be what we would say is bliss, a blessing of acceptance of reality. That's one option. The second option that spirit has is to defend against that mental chaos and saying, no, wait a minute. What spirit can do is say, well, I'm going to just decree myself prime creator, and then I'm going to change the laws of reality. I'm going to make my own laws. And so when spirit does this, it says, the new law of reality is that cause and effect are separate. And prior to experiencing the effect of a cause, of an idea, prior to that is something called time. Something prior to experiencing the effect, there's something prior to that. It's not instantaneous. So in other words, you have an idea, like what if I want to be prime creator, and before you experience the effect of that, which mind presents as total mental chaos, before that happens, something else prior to that happens. And that we call time. Okay. So time is like something, it's like the past. It's before. That means before effect of an idea is experienced, there's something else. Now, this something else, what are we doing with this? What is this something else? It's basically limiting loss, limiting chaos. it's saying that this is a precursor. We're working on the precursor. And what we say is, well, prior to this mental chaos, total mental chaos, there's some process, something else taking place, and it's a limited amount of chaos, a limited loss, and that we are experiencing this instead of the mental chaos. This enables spirit to say, to think, well, eventually what spirit hopes is that it will be able to get rid of this mental chaos or manage it perfectly, learn to manage it perfectly so it's not a problem. And so spirit can say, well, I'm prime creator and there is this total mental chaos, but I know how to deal with it. You see? So this is the second option that spirit can choose. And spirit chose that. Many aspects of spirit chose that. Time. Something prior to, a precursor to experiencing the effect of an idea. Now, this is just make-believe. This is not reality. But again, since spirit decided that it's going to just act as prime creator, it simply decrees that this is reality. This is how reality functions now. But it's not really how reality functions. We don't have the ability to change how reality functions. So what this really is, it's a like a dreamlike state, a hypothetical scenario, time. And in time, we're limiting loss, we're limiting chaos. That's why we have all this regimentation, that's why we have this order, this evolution of consciousness to try and develop greater and greater streamlined control. Okay. We want everything to be very much, we're trying to control chaos. That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to learn how to control chaos. How do we control it? And it's also a forestalling of experiencing mental chaos. It's saying it can't happen yet because we're prior to it happening. All this universe is prior to it, and we're working towards it. It's a delaying tactic. Time is all can also be seen as a delaying tactic. So here we are, and what we're really saying is, this is before we experience the effect. This before is the stuff we experience prior to experiencing the effect, and we're still working on that stuff. Of course, we want to work on it endlessly to make sure we don't experience the mental chaos. And we put the pot of gold on the rainbow, saying, "Well, we'll eventually be able to figure out how to manage total chaos." So that's the eventual hopeful payoff of this. So that is what time is. When you get comfortable with this, you can just say okay, and then at some point it all clicks and it all fits together, and you see all aspects, the whole big picture. In order to figure out how to get deliverance from time, you need to see what is time? What is the situation we're in? The fear, of course, we have is if we stop, let go of this forestalling effort, this prior precursor, if we say, okay, I'm done with the precursor, then we think, oh, then we're going to experience the effect of this idea, and we'll experience total chaos, mental chaos. So we're terrified of that. And we therefore keep time alive. Keep time alive. Keep this limited flow of limited loss alive. Of course, everything is impermanent. We see everything, we lose everything, but for a while, it's forestalled. For instance, every form you see in the world is temporary. You know it's going to decay and degrade and turn back into dust. Chaos, essentially. But for now, it hasn't happened yet. You see this tree, you see this bush, this plant, this wood here, and the concrete, everything you see, you say, See, this is not yet, not yet. I mean, keep up this constant flow. So yes, things from dust to dust go to return to dust, but we have all these new things constantly coming on the scene. So we can say, well, yeah, this hasn't yet returned to dust. So it's limited chaos. See, we're limiting it. It's a very amazing situation we've dreamed up here. So we're controlling it and limiting. Everything has a certain lifespan, you see. And it means for a while, this is not total mental chaos. This is not. This is, and then as it decays into that, there's all this other thingness in time that is not new and fresh and has its span too. And we just keep this going. We want to keep all this going. It's called limiting loss, believing that loss can be limited, but chaos can be limited this way. We see a new planted tree there, and that tree might live to be 50, 60 years. You know, and it'll slowly go through its cycles, and then it will break down, gradually break down and decay. And meanwhile, new trees are planted. And so we're continuously working on keeping time alive, keeping time alive. That's the cycles of birth and death, construction and destruction, all of that. This is our labor to forestall experiencing the effect of total mental chaos. So people don't want to, we don't want to let go of time. We want to keep time alive because it seems to be our salvation from total mental chaos. But it's not really our salvation because we have to keep working on keeping it alive. And that's very, very, very difficult and unrewarding labor, actually. We get very tired of that. And then we get worried. You know, when we start running out of steam, say, I'm so bored and tired of this. Then we start getting anxious. We don't know why. Because we feel, if I don't keep this going, I'm going to experience total mental chaos. Time will have ended, and therefore it means that the idea and its effect will finally be together again, as it were. In reality, ideas and their effects are together instantly. There's no gap. There's no separation. None. So we are just working on this, on time. That's where we're stuck. We're stuck in time. We're stuck in this dream of time, of impermanence. Stuck in the dream of impermanence. In this dilemma. We're afraid to let it go. I think that letting it go is disastrous for us. So the defenses against letting it go are extreme. Extreme defenses. Which is why the spiritual path is so difficult. Because this is the underlying dynamic of anxiety. It arises. People want to keep time going. They fear the consequences of not doing it. They think it's going to be terrible. Now, the way out, once you see what the problem is, the way out is very simple. You simply choose a new idea. Anything short of that is completely futile. Choose the idea of, well, I don't want to be prime creator. I accepting reality as it is perfect. That's what I want. And then there's no reason to try and separate cause and its effect. You can experience the effect of that. What if reality were permanent? The effect of that is bliss. No fear at all. No need for time. It's timelessness. There's nothing, no precursor to that effect of unconditional non-judgment upon all dreams, upon time. God is not judging time at all, because God knows that there's no separation between cause and effect. But until we get this overview of time, we're going to be too jittery. So it's really important to see where time comes from. Very important. Don't be in too much of a hurry to get to bliss, because that will come on its own accord. when we remove the obstacles to its presence. And the obstacle, the main obstacle to its presence is not recognizing what time is, not recognizing the nature of time. What is it? As long as we don't understand the big picture, we will think that right now is annihilation. You see, so we have to have the past. So it's not now yet. We're still in the precursor stage to now, and we're building something, building up towards it. We always feel we're working towards that something, right? We're always have this feeling, well, we're working towards something. That is time. We're working towards something. That's the feeling. That's the feeling of time. That's why the time doesn't feel right to us. Because, of course, we're created to experience cause and effect together without any gap whatsoever, without any precursors whatsoever, direct experiencing. So this feeling of like, well, I'm working towards experiencing is very, we get the sense of restlessness, and it's we don't like it. It's not natural to us at all. It's not normal, natural. And it feels very unnatural. There's something, I feel like there's something wrong. Like I can't quite, you know, I want to get something. I can't quite get it. Just out of reach. That's the feeling of time. Time has a feeling with it, a feeling of I'm not experiencing anything yet. I'm not there yet. I'm missing something. And so we go in search of, what are we missing? What are we missing? We get this feeling. And of course, advertisers exploit the feeling of time severely, which is why I always say, in a world that's configured properly, that you have to absolutely guard against the exploitation of this feeling of time, of feeling like you're missing something, and then advertising like, here's this product, this is what you're missing, you know, and then having a beautiful lady there, and she says, this product is what you're missing, you see. And what you really think is, oh, you're missing this beautiful lady, or so, you know. And it's all this advertising exploitive. It's exploitive of the feeling of time. And since we're all struggling with this, with time, because it's a defense, and it's something that requires very dedicated focus to cool down the fear of stepping into timelessness. You cannot have a culture that is dedicated to exploiting this uneasiness of time, the feeling of time that we're missing something. Otherwise, you're just going to become exploited. It becomes exploitative. This world right now is exploitative, super severely exploitative. It exploits this feeling of I'm missing something. How can I get it? How can I get, you know, this? I feel like I'm not quite there yet. And then we advertise, you know, this is how you get there. Whether it's a vacation, a home, relationships, things, everything like that is exploiting this feeling. I'm not quite there yet. I need, you know, how can I get, be happy and feel like I'm there? Like I'm getting something, I'm getting what I want. That's inherent within this whole situation of time, and the desire to be prime creator. It gives rise to this time and this inherent feeling of lack. So the right way to deal with this is clarification, not exploitation. So when you have a world that's based on exploitation, then the clarification becomes very problematical, because you're constantly bombarded with pseudo solutions that don't solve anything at all. They simply try to feed this appetite that you have, but the appetite never goes away. And things get worse and worse and worse and worse. The world goes into more and more and more debt, more and more and more debt. It civilization collapses eventually when we allow the exploitation of time that take place in a planet, you're headed towards collapse. So that is why it's super important to have rigorous austerity and humbleness, and people not agree not to be exploitive of this feeling of time. You there are certain steps that need to be taken. Severe limits on certain things. So, for instance, advertising. The use of the human form in advertising is a big no-no. Lending, you know, the whole debt thing is a big no-no. So what's happened, this planet has been exploited to an extraordinary extent. And of course, it never solves the problem. So you just have more and more and more of frustration, and we get deeper and deeper and deeper into a hole. And then you end up with the end of an age, a tribulation period. So if you're honest with yourself, you realize that you've always had this feeling your whole life. There's a substrate of this feeling, like I'm not quite experiencing what I want to experience. There's always this feeling that I need to reach somewhere, right, and get something. I'm missing it. There's always the feeling. It's the same feeling. The same feeling with everybody. Everybody has the same feeling, actually. That is the nature of the feeling of time. Time has a feeling. So the essence of spiritual religious teachings on the planet is the purpose of them is to make sure that society is not exploiting this feeling of time. It's not exploiting it. That instead we're facing it and seeing where does it come from, and looking at time. What is time? Why are we engaging with time like this? And then being delivered from it, deliverance from it, freedom and deliverance from time. It means stepping into timelessness. Timelessness simply means cause and effect, accepting that cause and effect are together. There's no gap between them. And when we accept the idea of not trying to be prime creator, then there's no worry about cause and effect being instantaneous. No worry at all. Because there's no annihilation effect there. No mental chaos effect that arises from that idea at all. None. So why would you, how could you possibly fear cause and effect being together without time? Don't need any time. Don't need a precursor to experience bliss. Why would you need a precursor to it? Is bliss dangerous? Is this frightening? No. So why would you say, no, I got to, first I have to spend, a trillion years working up to it. See, no, that's not, time isn't completely unnecessary. And again, you can take breaks, don't have to grab a hold of it. This is basic stuff. It's very simple and basic. It's not something that's going to disappear, it's not some complex equations or something like that. It's all based on fear. Once the fear is diminished, then you can simply see what is the situation. And it's not some real difficult mental task or something like that. It's just obvious. To the mind, there's this part of you just obvious, and so it's you don't have to like take notes on it, and say, oh my gosh, this is so complex and complicated. Now how am I going to remember this and all this stuff? Now it's the lessening of the fear of annihilation that you realize, oh wait a minute, I can choose a new idea. So cause and effect being together, not separated, is not a fearful concept, not something to be afraid of. Something to be looked forward to. Stepping out of time is something to look forward to. Now, from the standpoint of time, it seems like you're on the edge of an abyss. If you're looking at timelessness, it seems to be a bottomless abyss of annihilation. See, from the standpoint of time, But we're not looking at it from the standpoint of time, we're looking at it from the standpoint of reason. It's different, that's very different. So this is looked at from reason. So I don't see an abyss. The stepping time sees it as an abyss. So there's some little feeling like if I step into timelessness, I'll be stepping into abyss. That's what time says. But reason says, no. It's not true. No abyss whatsoever. It's time that's the abyss. We'll be stepping out of the abyss. That is the fact. We'll be stepping out of the abyss. So to the extent that we view things through the prism of time, we're going to be very confused and frightened, which is why reason is so extremely important. Real reason, not just plausible logic, but actual reason based on reason that has a foundation in truth, in reality. And so that is all important, very important. Because looking at it through the eyes, through the perspective of time, very fearful, very frightening. And so people try to do the spiritual clarification through the eyes of time in an attempt to get something, get rid of that feeling I'm lacking something. But you can't do it that way. They only will cause agitation, irritation, anger, frustration, fear, reactions of all sorts. Spiritual path cannot be taken that way. Cannot be taken from the motivation of time, saying I want to get what I'm missing, and the spiritual something there that I can get to make time satisfied, to satisfy. Then you look at it through the eyes of time, and you see that you're being led into an abyss. You think you're being led into an abyss to your annihilation, and so you're very worried about that, and you're looking if you can just grab something here. Maybe there's something to snatch I can grab, a treasure to drag back to my lair. You know, it's kind of like that. It's impossible to succeed in that way. So you have to let reason speak to your mind. You must let reason enter your mind. Otherwise, you will only be using time as a motivation, and your motivation is to try and snag some little trinket and drag it back to your lair and hope that that'll get rid of this feeling of incompleteness, of something missing. So you can never have have time without this feeling of incompleteness. It's impossible. But time keeps trying because it feels the alternative is to have annihilation. So it's time says, well, I have to learn to be happy with time. And somehow I've got to get rid of this feeling of incompleteness, but still maintain time. That's impossible. That's totally impossible. Because time is literally a denial of experiencing. So how can you experience the denial of experiencing? How can that be an experience that you are satisfied with? It cannot be. So reason has to be come alive in you. You have to get used to it so that you yourself can reason, start reasoning. And looking at it through the eyes of reason instead of the eyes of time. Otherwise, the fear will be too much. You, no way in the world you can make the final step out of the abyss of time, out of the imaginary abyss of time. Time is just an illusion of an abyss. It's actually completely flat and only has one moment to it. And yet it is a very, through the eyes of time, time does seem to have depth and breadth and all of that to it, but it doesn't really. I mean, how much time does the past really have? We think it's only a dream of this one little gap, this dream of a gap. So it's not really an abyss. It's like a grain of sand. How can you get How can you call a grain of sand an abyss? And that's what the awakened ones tell us. They laugh and say, I thought this grain of sand was an abyss. It's very funny for the humorous for them. That's what I've been told, is that when you step out of this imaginary abyss, you have a good chuckle, because you say, now wait a minute, all this time I thought this little tiny speck of dust was a total abyss. It's really funny. All the while the elephant was terrified of the mouse. That's what they say, and I can see how kind of getting a sense of that, not having done it myself, but working towards that. So time is the great bluffer. Time is the great liar, the great deceiver. It says, look how much there is of me. Billions of years, and look at all this. Time and space is so vast and gigantic and all this stuff. It really is just a grain of sand. It's just a whimsical instant. An instant of whimsy is all there is to it. What we're really experiencing here in Northern California is Southern California weather, actually. It's like summer in Southern California kind of here right now, Northern California. It's just amazing. Totally spoiled. I'm looking at this gorgeous orange tree full of blossoms, flowers, and just... absolutely clear and sparkling day, and gentle breeze, upper 70s maybe, mid to upper 70s. Very gentle, beautiful day. And yet, instead of indulging in it, here we are talking about time. You see? Life is not all a Mediterranean cruise, a Greek island cruise. Be careful about that. I haven't spent my time cruising the Greek islands. Mostly just sitting in a chair here, trying to focus in on time. What's the problem? What is this problem? What are we having? And what we need ultimately to do is see time as really just a grain of sand. That's all that it is. So when we talk about steps to be taken, that is a goal. Is one to don't force these realizations. Don't force them, because you won't get them. Because when you try to force them, you're going through the eyes of time. How can time see itself as a grain of sand? It's not possible. There must be something else within us that can see it that way. Time sees itself as infinitely vast, stretching on forever, because it's all an attempt to forestall total mental chaos. So, of course, time needs to see itself as permanent and endless. With the caveat of saying, well, at some point there's a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow, but we're not there yet. Now, time can repeat itself. A grain of sand can duplicate itself, repeat itself over and over and over. And we think, wow, there's this vast beach, vast Sahara Desert of sand. But it's really only just a grain of sand. That's all the time is. It's just a instant of whimsy, of saying, well, wait a minute, what if cause and effect were not one? What if they were separate? It's a what if they were separate? And oh, then well, what's prior to experiencing it? Ah, time. There's this priorness. It's precursor. What's the precursor? So it's a dream, it's a whimsy of precursor. Precursorness. And how big is the precursor? It's just this little tiny grain of sand of whimsy. the work ethic is all important. And here we are on this absolutely fabulous picture postcard kind of day. And what are we doing? We're grinding it out here. We're, you know, putting in maximum effort here. I guess there's a saying in New York, if you can make it here, you can make it anywhere. Well, the fact is, if you can get free of time, step out of time in California, you can do it anywhere, because the distractions here are so extreme. You know, why go through this very, very, you know, this clarification and do this if you could be out, you know, in a convertible, cruising up to some lake or I don't know, whatever. I don't know what people do here, but all I know is they all seem to disappear on the weekends constantly. Everybody's doing something, that is for sure. And so there's this enormous distraction here of you're supposed to be out doing something, because how can you waste this incredible weather? Best weather in the world, for sure. It's just amazing. You should be out doing something, right? And yet here we are in a little nook here just saying, no, let's talk about stepping out of time. How can we step out of time? Flip side to that is that you, in living here, you recognize this is not the answer. You still don't have it. The feeling of time is still here, even in this, like, you know, many people say this is the best place in the world as far as this world goes, as far as climate and just everything, all the distractions, the mountains, the ocean, the beautiful valleys. It's just got it all. California has it all, the deserts, you name it, it's got it all. And in here you realize this feeling of time is the same. You can't get away from it. No matter where you go in the world, you'll still have it. So even in the most salubrious place in the world, which just seems almost like paradise, the feeling is the same. And then you say, uh-oh, I'm in big trouble, because I thought I could move somewhere, I thought I could live somewhere and I get free of it, then no. So really, being born in California was a blessing, because you find out that just being born somewhere, just living somewhere, is not the answer. It will never be the answer. And that's the challenge of California, for instance, is that you can realize that it's never going to be an answer. Where you live will never be an answer. It's futile. And that gets kind of frightening, which is why in California there's a lot of spiritual movements, a lot of therapy movements, and all this stuff comes out of California, because people say, whoa, this isn't it. We need to do something else, do something more, do the rebirthing and Rolfing and Feldenkrais and Kinesis and encounter groups and body work and chanting and this and this and this. And it's the birthplace of all these modalities and therapies and something else, trying to, you know, get rid of this feeling of time, because they realize, gosh, I can only sit on, you know, go down to Big Sur and contemplate the ocean for so long, and I still have this feeling. You can watch the sunset over the Pacific and the beautiful, you know, coastline and the trees and everything, the fog, everything's just like, wow, but I still have this feeling that I'm incomplete. And I say, oh my gosh, I better go, you know, go to the hot tub, see, go down to Esalen, sit in the hot tub, and then drink the wine in the hot tub, and then get Rolfed and massaged, and then eat organic food, and then take a stroll, then meditate, watch the sunset, all this. You know, okay, but wake up in the, go, have to go to sleep, wake up, move this body around. I still have this feeling like it's not quite enough. I'm still not quite enough. What do you do then, you see? May have to take a break right here. Let's see.